Right. So yesterday and Friday, I think probably yesterday you have seen the control in actions. Basically, you have a flow control. Of course, with flow control, you cannot really see what happening inside physically, right? With the liquid level control, then you can have a feeling how it is because you can see the liquid level. And then also you have that temperature control. Okay. So among these three control, which one do you like best? You see, which one do you like best? Liquid level control, flow control, or the temperature control? Which one do you like the best? Is that liquid level control? Because you can see it by yourself, right? Directly. How about you? For example, how about you, Selena? Which one do you like better? Temperature level or flow? You joined us yesterday, right, Selena? So the thing that you can see, I think normally the one that you prefer lah. But basically by having a hands-on and three control, then you can pick which one is the one that your group wants to choose, and that will be better because you can spend much more time to do something that is deeper rather than you do two. Level is easier to observe, yeah, of course lah. Level is easy. Okay, so today we will continue again on our feedback controls that we overview last week. Okay, we are going ahead of time actually because this is supposedly week six, but actually week seven we have two materials. One is the design of feedback controllers, the other one is the control instrumentation and tuning. So because I utilize my lecture sessions to compensate for the hands-on session for the laboratory, that means I can only cover one portion of the material this week. Okay, so next week we will cover another one again, control instrumentation and tuning. Then I think the following week, if I'm not wrong, the following week will be, what is that week? I will have one more week with you on the process control. Then I think on the 19th, that will be taken by Dr. Vignesh. Okay, he will come over and basically do continue with all the lectures. Okay, he will join us reporting starting on this 18th, if not wrong. Okay. Anyway, if you have anything that you want to ask me about the process control, then you are still free to ask because I'm still your unit convener. Okay. So today we're gonna go into the design of the feedback controllers. So at the end of this lecture, you should be able to select the type of the feedback controller, proportional PI or PID controller. Okay. Then how to adjust the parameters of the selected controller, which is the KC, TI, and TD, to achieve an optimum response for the control process. This is actually a part of your control laboratory as well, where you are asked to play with the gain, with the reset time, and the rate time. Okay. So by connecting the theory with the response that you get from the laboratory control, you will have a better idea of how the control is working because this one is the basic one for the process control, for the control. Okay, so figure one in here shows the response of a control process to a unit step change. What you mean by a unit step change is, let's say for example, at the particular time of t equals 0, we change the steady state value from one point, from point A to point B. Then we know that if we have no control, then our steady state will move into a new steady state where there is no control. If we use a proportional control, then our steady state will still change, but it will not be the same with the no control. Okay, so it will move into a new steady state value, but the new steady state value will be less in terms of the departure from the initial steady state. If you use a PI, it will go back into the old steady state value because you basically reset that you reset your control so that the steady state does not change. For the PID, you can see that the fluctuations is even lower than the PI. So you can see that the different controllers have different effects on the response of the control process. Then you will ask yourself, what type of feedback controller should I use to control a given process? Okay, so if we assume that we have decided to use a PI control, we need to have to decide the two values of the gain, KC, and the reset time. Okay, these two figures, figure 3, 2A and B, demonstrate how these two parameters exhibit an important effect on the response of your control process. The first one depicts when your reset time is made constant. So if the KC 3 is made much higher than the KC 1 and KC 2, so KC 1 is here, KC 2 is here, then KC 3 is here. So you're changing basically from the underdamped into the overdamped, or this one is probably a critically damped process. Okay, now if your KC is a constant, this is the effect where you increase the TI, the reset time, then you are also changing it from the underdamped process into the critically damped process. Okay, everybody get it up to this point? When I said underdamped, then you see that there is a critical point then where you see this is underdamped in here. Okay. Well, I'm at this particular point. It's good that I want to that I also want to point out a bit of tips for your test one. Okay, just consider this as a bit of my help to you for your process control test to be held tomorrow. Okay. Let me go into this learning materials, okay? You want to go into this week 3. Okay, week 3, this is this one, I think. Week 3 open. Okay, don't forget the definitions of the... Okay. Wait, I think I opened the wrong ones. I should open the week 3 one, not that one. Huh? So let me open this one. And then let me open the week 5 lecture as well. Huh? Don't forget to remind yourself on the definitions of the steady state gain, guys. So steady state gain is the ratio of the output variable change to an input variable change when the input is adjusted to a new value and held there, thus allowing the process to reach a new steady state. So it's very important if any problem asks you for what is the value of the gain, you need to read from the problem statement what is the change in the output. Okay, go with the steady state. After the unit step input is applied with the initial steady state. At the same time, you need to also define what are the change in the input variables. That will be how you calculate the steady state gain. Okay, I think this has been given in your tutorial, but it's very important that you go again and make sure that you are familiar with this concept again. Okay, this may came out in your test one. Okay, and then also important for you to understand on the process under them, critically them, and over them this process. Okay, and the transfer function. Okay, the characteristics of the under them response in here, all the examples that is given in here, including the examples that are given in the tutorials. If you want to score highly on the test one, okay. So that's very important that you, that's just a tip for your test one. Okay. Now we come across the second design question. How do we select the best values for the adjustable parameters of a feedback controller? So this is known as the controller tuning problem. But before we can answer these two design questions, we need to have a quantitative measure to compare the alternative so that we know Which controller actually performed the best, okay, including the value of each parameter. The question number three will be the performance criterion that we need to use for the selection and tuning of the controller. So there are many different performance criteria. The first one is to keep the maximum deviation as small as possible, achieve short settling times, minimize the integral of the errors until the process has settled to its desired point, and so on. So the key is that the different performance criteria may lead to different control design. It's very important in here because if you go back into this particular process, for example, if you go into this particular process where you have these things, it's very important that you know what is this thing. There is a settling time, for example, or you want to limit, you want to make sure that the process does not give deviations in terms of A. So the A should not be much higher than what is allowed. Okay, you basically want to design a controller where you have a minimum A, a deviations from your steady state value, for example, your steady state value or non steady state value. That's very important that you specify that thing in here. Therefore, we know that the different performance criteria would lead to different control designs. Okay, so these are the example. You have a two different feedback control systems that with A and B in here. Okay, if our criterion for the design of the controller is to return to the desired level of operation as soon as possible, then clearly we would select the controller that give the closed loop response of, okay, but return to the desired level of operation, okay, because this one is the desired level of operations in here, meaning that you basically reach this level quicker in here, right? Because this one will be quicker in terms of the change in here, so you are reaching this particular point quicker for A compared with B. But if your criteria had been to keep the maximum deviation as small as possible, then A will not be the best because the A in here exhibit this much of the deviations, whereas B in here does not exhibit that much deviation. This process in here is what we call as an underdamped, right? Whereas the process in here is what we call as a critically damped process. So what are the possible criteria that you can do? You can use a steady state performance criteria. Therefore, the zero error at steady state. This cannot be achieved using a proportional controller because your gain would have to be infinite in order for you to achieve zero offset. Okay, PI controller on the other hand can achieve this. If you use a dynamic response performance criteria, criteria that uses only, you can use two different criteria. Use a criteria that use only a few points of the response, or the criteria that use the entire closed loop response from t equals 0 up to t very large. This probably something that is attainable in practice. Okay, we will not go with something that is very large, but something that will be tolerable and practical in terms that you don't really have to wait for very, very long time. These two will be more precise, but also more complicated to use. The other things is that you can use is the semi-empirical rules, meaning semi-empirical rules is that some part of it coming from the theory, but some part of it is also coming from your experiments. So you have two method. One is the open loop, which is Cohen-Kuhn. The other one is the closed loop method, which is the Ziegler-Nichols. This again go back into your characteristic of the underdamped response. So something like an overshoot, rise time, settling time, decay ratio, or frequency of collision of the transient. However, you have to pick in actual conditions your controller design. You cannot use several different criteria at the same time, because one criteria may be in conflict with the other criteria. Okay, so for example, this one is shown in here that the KC one higher than the KC two higher than the KC three in here. So decreasing the value of this overshoot by decreasing the value of gain KC leads to increase in the settling time. So if your criteria is overshoot and your criteria is settling time, then you will have a trade-off between these two criteria. Okay, understand up to this point, right? I think it's not something that are a bit that are difficult. For a criteria that use only a few points of the response, these are, I think, from all the performance criteria in the previous slide, the decay ratio has been the most popular. So this C divided by A should be equal to a quarter. Okay, this normally give a reasonable trade-off between the fast rise time and reasonable settling time. Okay, the criterion in here is usually known as the one quarter decay ratio criterion. This one is the criterion that my students like to use when he uses an Aspen Plus. This is good for simulations, I think. In the real conditions, also sometimes it's used as well. But you have a different objective in here. So you have a three IS integral of the square error, ISE integral of the absolute value of the error, integral of the time weighted absolute error. This three has a different purpose. Then you will ask me which one should I use. So you need to go into this slide and check in here. So if you want to suppress large error, then ISE will be better than IAE. For this reason in here. If you want to suppress small errors, then IAE is better than ISE. Okay. If you want to suppress error that you think will continue for a long time, then the ITEE will be the best criterion, because you have a T in your error formula in here that will have a role in deciding the value of the ITAE. This later can be you can apply these things later in your Aspen Plus Dynamics in your tutorials, I think. Okay. Generally, if you decide which control structure give you the best, then these are the one that you use in your simulations in the Aspen Plus Dynamics. Either any of these, which one is it? Depending on the on what you want. If the three or four control structure that you use is all of them giving you only a small error, then normally they what you put is IAE. These are the figures that give you the idea or the comparisons on if you tune using ITEE, IEE, and ISE, what kind of fluctuations you will get. Okay, they are not very far away from each other, but you can see that they are different with each other, of course. Therefore, for the same integral criterion and different input changes leads to different designs. Okay, so if we keep using this criterion of the entire closed loop response from time t equals 0 to t very large, when you ask me about the closed loop response, meaning that you are basically tuning your controller when it's operating, okay? So it's different with the open loop. In the open loop, meaning that you don't install your control loop at all. But for closed loop response, you are actually installing your control loop, and you are also tweaking the value of the P, the gain, the reset time, and the rate time in here. Okay, so this is what you did. What you did: define an appropriate performance criteria, which one you choose between these three. Compute the value of the performance criterion using whichever the control system you put in. And then you change, you adjust the value of the KC, TI, and TD in here. And then you select the control that gives the best value for the performance criterion. This is good for simulations, okay? But in the real situation, probably not very good because it is quite tedious. It relies on the models and it incorporates certain ambiguities as to which is the appropriate criterion and what input changes to consider. If you are able to do it in the same way that Luiben did the project one that you did using the MATLAB code, that one, but you apply to a different plan-wide process control, then it's very easy for you to use this ISE, IEE, and ITEE. This is why even Luiben, Prof. Luiben himself, he used two different software to analyze the plan-wide process control. In the past, he used a Fortran. Then when MATLAB came, because many people in many chemical engineering students and professors in the world, they use a MATLAB. So he convert into the MATLAB some of his code, the old code from his back in his time. Then at the same time, he also do his simulation using Aspen Plus Dynamics. This can be easily done using an Aspen Plus Dynamics to find the ISE, IAE, and ITEE. Okay, so if we just go into the general qualitative consideration instead of going into something that is complicated, then these are what it is. Proportional control will accelerate the response of a control process. It will give you an offset, except those with the term 1 over S, okay, in their transfer function, such as the liquid level in the tank or the gas pressure in a vessel. Integral control eliminates the offset. However, the elimination of the offset comes at the expense of higher maximum deviations. Therefore, it produces a sluggish and long oscillating response. If we increase the gain at the same time to produce a faster response, we will do that at the price of instability. The derivative control, on the other hand, it anticipates future error and introduces appropriate action. It's adding the stabilizing effect on the closed loop response of a system. Then you can easily go to say that the PID is the best. Why don't we just use a PID? Because you are adding one extra parameters that you need to tune in order for you to be able to get the right operation mode for the PID controller. Therefore, you need to use these following rules of thumb. If possible, use simple proportional controller, such as for your liquid level. However, if it is not acceptable for you to have an offset, then use a PI. PID controller is used only to increase the speed of the closed loop response and retain robustness. So the other alternative way is the semi-empirical rules, which is the open loop method and the closed loop methods. So in the open loop method in here, is what you need to do is you need to consider where we basically open the connections in the closed loop control systems by simply cutting off these things in here. Okay, so we disconnect the controller from the final control element in here. The one that we put in the brackets in here, in the dashed lines, the squares in here is the process in here, okay? Note that in your control systems, you have a disturbance and you have the manipulated variables, okay? The output from your process will be your particular process that you control. So that particular control process will be measured using the transfer functions of the measurement system. So whatever you get in here will be different with here, because this one will be mm, a small subscript in here is the measured value. Okay, then you will compare it. Note that you have this one is plus, this one is minus. So The set point is have to be subtracted by the measured value. Then you will get an error. Okay, if you get the error in here, then you basically go in transfer functions of your controller. Okay, then the controller also will adjust the thing into the final control element. So what essentially happened in here, if you want to use the open loop method, is you detach the connections between the controller and the final control element. Okay, and then you apply in a unit step change. You put into your final control element. Okay, so you are working basically manually. You introduce a step change of magnitude A in the variable C, which will basically operate the final control element. If it is in the case of a valve, then C is the steam position. Then you record the value of the output, this YM in here, with respect to time. The curve is called the process reaction curve. Okay, between YM and YM and C in here, you have three different transfer function. Okay, F, P, and M. F, P, process, and M. So this means that the equation 5 shows that the process reaction curve is affected not only by the dynamics of the main process, but also by the dynamics of the measuring sensor and the final control element. In most of the cases, you will have something like this. Okay, because you are putting in a unit step change, you will get something like this. The response of the MOS processing units to an input change has a sigmoidal shape in here. This is something that we call the first order plus dead time system. Your TD is coming from here, and then this is the you have an approximation of the first order. Okay, so if you use this, you can approximate that response using equation 6 in here. Okay, that connects the output from the measuring, from the measurement systems with respect to your control. Okay, this they have three parameters in here: the static gain, the time, and the time constant. This first order plus the time is something that are very useful and that has been used again and again in the control area. Okay, so the figure 8b in here reveals that these three parameters can be estimated as follows. So K will be output at steady state divided by input at steady state. B, isn't it? What is that? B divided by A. A is the steady state. You go back again into your these things again. This gives you the understanding into your steady state gain. Okay. And this time constant will be equal to B divided by S. So that's your B divided by the slope, where S is the slope of the sigmoidal response at the point of inflection. A TD is equals to that time, which is the time elapsed until the system responded. So you have some period of time that the system does not seem to be responded until this particular point. So that particular point is called a TD. So this can be, we have an application of something called the inflection point method, where the inflection point is the first determine where the slope of the reaction curve goes through its maximum, following figure 9. So you're doing it using this one, using the inflection. If the tangent line is a tangent drawn at that point, at this particular point, will intersect the, you notice that the slope will change in terms of the magnitude, right? Because in here you have this slope like this. At this particular point you have a slope like this. At this particular point you have this slope in here. So the slope will in reality increase from this particular point to this particular point. At this particular point, the slope becomes maximum. If you take the slope at this particular point, then the slope it will this slope at this particular point will be slower than the slope at this particular point. So this is what is called the inflection point, because that is the point of the maximum slope. Because any movement, if you go backwards, then the slope will decrease. If you go above, then the slope will decrease. That's why it is called an inflection point. So if we continue with this test, where we basically put in a unit step test into these things, and then we can measure the response that we get from the particular system. What we can do essentially is following any of these three. Either we use a 1/4 decay ratio, minimum offset, or minimum integral square error. So if you use a proportional controller, this is where you will get your value of the Kc. Okay, so this K, you get it from here. The time constant, tau, you get it from here. The Td, you also get it from here as well, the time. Then you will be able to get your Kc. For proportional integral controllers, this will be the formula. We will not cover the derivations into these things, but if you want to refer, you can go back into the papers by Cohen and Kuhn. Okay. On the other hand, if you use a proportional integral derivative controller, then these are the semi-empirical formula that Cohen Kuhn give for you to determine the value of the Kc, Ti, and Td in here. Okay. That will be this one, which is belonging to the open loop method. Now we go into the next one, is the closed loop method. Okay. So we first go into the Ziegler-Nichols. The step for the Ziegler-Nichols tuning technique are as follows. You switch the controller to automatic mode with proportional control action only. By trial and error, you find the ultimate gain. Okay, this will be the smallest value of the proportional controller gain that will produce sustained oscillation in YT. So this sustained oscillation meaning that if you go above this, then it's more likely to be unstable. Okay. You record the KU because KU is at the verge of the stability. And the period of the sustained oscillation, this one is TP or PU. Then the optimum controller setting can be calculated using the formula shown in Table 1 in here. The most important thing is for you to get this KU and the PU. PU in here is equal to the TP basically. Okay, once you get these things, then you will be able to find the different proportional, different gain, different reset time, and different rate time for different type of the controller. The Ziegler-Nichols, I think the background is, if not wrong, the electrical engineer, I think. So it's they develop these systems not only for the chemical process control only, but also for something that is more general. Okay, I think that's pretty much everything that I cover today, guys. So we have basically go into the little bit into the design. We talk about how. Did you do the controller tuning? Okay, and then in general, when do you want to use a proportional? When do you want to use an integral? When do you want to use a derivative? You want to add derivative controller into your PI. Okay. Any questions, guys? Or if not, then I let you go for your lunch. I think this is probably a bit late lunch. I think you all of you must be hungry. Any questions that you have? Alvin, Amanda, Clarence, Daniel, James, Jason, Juliana, Cising, Michael, Taha, Rachel, Selena, Tiffany, Yusi, Wong Yo, Weising. Anything? No? you get better, more clear at this particular point. Design of the feedback control system. Okay, good. You just revise it back, whatever you want to revise back again, and then I have given you a bit of tips as well on your test for tomorrow. Don't forget your test for tomorrow, and then also keep track of your due dates. I think this is the time where you start having quite a lot of the submissions, and I'm happy to have meeting with you or to answer your questions if any. Stay well. Okay. Let me turn off my recording here.